As the power levels rise in our modern crop of performance engines, at some point the factory internal components are going to cry enough. And this is where aftermarket components such as crankshafts, connecting rods and pistons come in. And we're here with Jim from Nitto Performance Engineering to find out a little bit more about what goes into developing aftermarket engine components. Now Jim, for a start, you're no stranger to the performance industry, and for those who aren't aware, you're the original owner of Croydon Racing Developments, and yep. Particularly over your time at Croydon Racing Developments, you saw the development of the Japanese import market of cars, and in particular, you seem to have an affinity to the Nissan brand. And where did you sort of start developing the idea for Nitto Performance Engineering?
The idea came in around 1998. I've been in the industry since the late 80s, and had the Croydon Racing Developments for nearly 30 odd years. And so I saw a need myself to expand what we were already doing. As you said, we're heavily involved in the motorsport industry, in the Jap import scene back then. I affectionately call it rice burners in the 80s. So we were at the forefront of that. We were one of the first shops in New South Wales or in Sydney to start working on the Japanese import cars. And to be able to sort of expand from what we were already doing, you know, we're doing so much with a lot of the Japanese cars, you know, be it your little Suzukis back in the 80s, WRXs, Evos, GDRs, which as you just mentioned is our affectionate little babies. And so we felt the need to sort of go that next level and start expanding our range, and also being able to offer the public something that wasn't currently available at that time.
Now, let's dive in. I know you're definitely not limited to the Nissan market, but let's just focus on the Nissan. We've got this beautiful R34 behind us, and the RB26, despite the fact that it is well-loved and well-proven to make huge amounts of power, let's be honest, it is an engine that is not without its faults that need to be addressed in the aftermarket. So there's the block itself, but what we really want to talk about is the rotating assembly, which is where Nitto comes in. And one of the factors is 2.6 litres is pretty limited, particularly when you're competing against a 3-litre 2JZ. So you've developed stroker kits as well. Can you talk us through the process of developing these stroker kits?
Yeah, sure. So again, basically working on the Skylines from the mid-90s, you know, we found the need to sort of extend and expand the range and make more horsepower and make it reliable. So, you know, we were back in the days where we had an all-wheel drive dyno, and seeing 200 kilos the wheels out of one of our first R32s was like, whoa, you know, it was pay dirt, you know, it was back, wow. And then it sort of went to 600 kilowatts at the wheels. And then we had milestones along the way, and we found that we had to make components that would actually live. We found the limits, you know, back in those days as well, but we were lucky enough to be at the forefront of what was going on. And and saw limitations, and in a one sense, what we would do is be able to see, okay, we're coming up against a brick wall here. What can we do to make it go the next step without having to destroy things? So again, that's when the need came in to go bigger capacity, more RPM, makes more horsepower, you know, and the thing goes on. So yeah, we ended up with a 2.7 kit, which was the popular kit for the day. Then developed a 2.8 kit, which has now been proven to be the go-to 2.8 if you're running an RB26 block. And eventually the 30s came along. There was a time where, and I clearly remember this back in the late 90s, when the go was RB30s don't rev, they destroy themselves, they've got harmonic issues and yada 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 from other shops. And it's like, okay, but it's got a good stroke, it's got a good rod ratio, that crank looks like crap. Okay, let's see if we can do something with it. So it'd be fair to say that we instigated that change in the RB30, which then allowed those motors to rev and be reliable and reduce harmonics, which used to crack the original RB30 blocks, and then develop develop further and go into the RD blocks and so on and so on. And then you've got cars like this, which are now happily revving at 10,000 RPM, and Rob Margins R32, running our reciprocating components in there at the moment, and that's happy to rev to 11,500.
It's a hell of a lot of RPM for sure, particularly to remain reliable, but of course that's what you need if you want to beat the best in the world. In terms of actually developing a crankshaft for an engine like this, sort of, what is your process? Do you use sort of CAD CAM to design the crankshaft and go through finite element stress analysis, or is it literally a case of developing the crankshaft, putting it in an engine and testing it?
Initially you'd run through a process where you would do your testing and now computer simulation, but back in the 90s we didn't have access to that, so we'd have to come up with something which we believe was going to be good. We'd have to then run it through a process, whether it's, for example, our crankshafts when we manufacture them now, go through a process when they're actually finished, we get them all spun up and balanced at 9,000 RPM. So we know nowadays that they're perfectly balanced and, you know, they do what they've got to do with our reciprocating mass. But back in the early days, we didn't have the CAD CAM stuff and whatever else. We'd have to go by experience, and then you learn things along the way, and things that we'd done in the earlier days with other engines, we put that along with this thing and developed. And yeah, there's trial and errors, and you know, some things going to work and some things don't work. You know, we found some things that I was really happy with, and there were some things where I've gone, nah, I don't like that, that's going to create a problem, back to the drawing board, redo it and whatever else. So
One of the things we see with production crankshafts and either some of the aftermarket crankshafts is that while when we're fitting the crankshaft to the engine block, it obviously is what appears to be a completely rigid item, but what that crankshaft's actually looking like inside the engine at 10, 11,000 RPM with 80 or 90 PSI of boost into the engine, it's becoming much more flexible, and that can cause a problem, particularly with bearing life. So exactly. What are you doing in the design of the crankshaft to try and improve the rigidity?
Yep, so what you basically said there is something that we found once we start going over 2,000 horsepower with our RB cranks, RB30 cranks or 3.2s, running the 4340. Cranks were, you know, they did what they had to do, but then once you start running over 2,000 horsepower at the wheels, you start to see a bit of uneven bearing wear. You can see where in the centre main it started to get a bit of a lick up the centre bearing, and then you go, okay, well, is that a bit of block flex? Yeah, but you know, that's good. It's also a bit of crank flex because you see it in the rest of the bearings. And then once we sort of went, okay, well, now we're going to go for another material because we know that there's something better out there, and we were able to come up with a EN40B and use a similar design. Weight's about the same, but now we have a situation where we're making 2,500, 2,600 horsepower at the engine, and that same crankshaft, that EN40B crank, the bearings are absolutely perfect. After doing maybe 2,000 plus horsepower runs on a dyno, we pull it apart, yep, it's all good, okay, to the track.
So that's just the difference between the 4340 and the EN40B material.
Yeah, that's mainly the material. I have developed another crankshaft, which is we've just shown snippets of what's up and coming through our social media. So again, being at the forefront of the RB scene, I've been able to, one, I tune because I tune June. I've been able to see how aggressive we can get away with the tune before we start to sort of hurt the Achilles heel at the moment, which is the big end bearings.
All right, so let's talk about that big end bearing, because as you've mentioned there, that can be a limiting factor with a lot of engines, the size of the bearing and basically how much load that bearing can support, and particularly have problems if maybe the tune's a little bit off and run into a small amount of detonation, then that can push the bearing through the oil film and basically quickly destroy the bearing. So what are your options there? What can you do, particularly when you're building a custom crankshaft?
So what we've actually done is we've come up with a bearing which is available off the shelf, which is now a 20.5 millimetre wide big end bearing.
And the stock bearing width is 17?
Yep, it's a 17 millimetre, so we've got an increase of about 20%. We've done that by not reducing the diameter of the crankshaft, so we've been able to keep the same, what we call crossover between the main and the big end bearing.
And that crossover there, a bit hard to show without a bit of a graphic, but that helps with the rigidity because you've actually got material crossover between the main journal and the big end journal.
Yeah, no, exactly right. So we've been able to maintain that, and by then adding more material around the webbing, because we've taken a little bit off the width of the crankshaft, where the big end is. We've come up with a bearing which we now push a lot more than what we'd been able to push, a 17 mil bearing. So,
yeah, and 20% improvement or increase in width is massive. So you can sort of apply that to the power level, then yeah, that's going to make a massive difference. Okay, so we've talked about the crankshaft there. Another thing of the RB in particular, and we see this with a lot of engines, the sintered material that they use to make the oil pumps is a known weak point. Yeah. Basically, rev it past about 8,000 RPM and the thing's going to fall to pieces. Yep. And you're talking about revving to 10, 11,000 RPM. What are you doing with aftermarket oil pumps for the RB?
Yeah, well, we've manufactured an oil pump quite some time back, and it's worked quite effectively for a number of years. So we've got a lot of engines that are, we've got hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of pumps which I personally build myself. So everything is actually hand built and hand matched up. So, and then what we've done is recently, because we've got a, we're getting a request now from more guys that want to run, like this car just ran an 8.4. It's running our new sine drive oil pump, which is basically essentially our oil pump with a new inner gear with a different drive. So to get the different type of drive, again, it's a bit hard to explain. So what we've been able to do is come up with a drive which is which runs successfully and reliably on an engine which is running low eights now. So it's a wet sump car. And we've been able to then make our own drive, which then goes over the existing crankshaft, so you machine the crankshaft down to put our drive on it, and along with the wider gear that we've got, plus the ribbing on the side of the gear itself, we've been able to extend the drive of the gear a substantial amount, whereas we're distributing the massive two-step loading, because that's where these things are going to break, they're going to break, the loading across the whole gear, so it's a lot more even, a lot more drive. We've actually got 12 drive surfaces instead of the traditional two. And we're allowing for the RB30s, especially where they get a little bit of movement in the crankshaft or whatever else, to have a bit of that play still in between the gear and the drive itself.
So you don't actually want it too rigid to the crank?
No, definitely not. That doesn't go well with pumps. It'll tend to destroy a pump in no time.
So again, for those who may be a little bit familiar with the RB26, the factory drive you kind of mentioned here is just like two flats that drives the pump, and obviously the early crankshafts were problematic because that drive was too short, not fully engaging in the oil pump drive as well. So numerous problems in there, but this sine drive basically better supportive, what I'm understanding is better supportive of that driven oil pump gear, and that's going to make it more reliable, particularly for the likes of two-step.
Yeah, a lot more reliable. So whereas with a two flat, so essentially you had a round circumference and you had one flat on one side and right opposite there's another flat. So then you had two sharp points which dig into the gear, essentially dig into the gear to drive it. Now what we found in our own manual testing, so I'd made up a jig which I can actually exert, you know, 600-700 foot pounds of torque on a stocky type gear, I could get that gear eventually to go slightly out of round, right? And when it slightly goes out of round, even if it's a couple of thou, you know at some stage or somewhere down the track that might have an issue if it's consistently banged on a 1,000, 1,200 horsepower. This thing's making way over that, but say 1,300 or 1,400 horsepower engine. And especially when it's two-stepping, you know, or launch controlling, that sort of stuff.
That real harsh cutting.
Real harsh, bang, bang, backwards, forwards. So then, by having that knowledge of these things since the 90s and knowing where they would fail if they did fail, again, being proactive, we've gone, okay, we need to come up with something because we feel this is going to be the next thing that people are going to want. So let's give them something before they want it, so to speak. So it's already on the market, which means it's going to be somebody can pick it up anytime, now office, and before they encounter an issue, we've got a solution for them.
It's also nice for the guys who are out there who don't really want to go to the expense and complexity of adding a dry sump system into their builds.
Yeah, I mean, we've, and to test oil pressure, my oil pumps have actually, we deliberately blocked off the oil pressure valve years ago to see how much oil pressure we could actually get out of our pumps. We're running close to 250 PSI. So it was 230 to 250 PSI in the late 90s, early 2000s. Just to see how far we could go, like this particular engine here runs way over 100 PSI pressure. You need that for the bearings to live and whatever else. But our pump's capable of doing it because it's got the the 12 drives, which means it can exert an even amount of force over those 8 drives, so it's not going to get loaded to be egg-shaped, so to speak.
Again, I just want to mention that we have been focusing pretty solely on the RB, but of course Nitto make products for a range of other engines. And if our viewers want to find out a little bit more, where can they go to?
Oh, you can go to our website. It's www.nitto.com.au, and it's pretty straightforward. There's information there. Social media, if they just go on, we've got Facebook and we got Instagram, and my young guy is a genius with that social media stuff because he's 21 and I'm over 50, so he does all my social media, so there's more on that every day. So you're more than welcome to go on there and have a look. So it's Nitto Performance Engineering is our Facebook, and Nitto Performance, I think it's at Nitto Performance Engineering.
We'll tag it.
Yeah, that's it. For our Instagram, so yeah, cool.
Perfect. Thanks a lot for the chat, Jim.
Thank you very much. Cheers.
If you like that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up. And if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson.